Now, before I get started, this is going to sound like it's some sort of advertisement, but it's not. It's actually this. It's Guinness. And Guinness is what brought you today's lecture. Now, the reason why did Guinness bring you today's lecture is because Guinness is actually responsible for the statistics that we're learning today. Guinness was part of the origin of the t-test. And so we're going to talk a little bit about that. And then maybe later on, you know, much later on after I've recorded this lecture, I'll have a little bit of this Guinness, very good stuff. Now that you've seen how Guinness beer could be possibly related to what we're going to be talking about today, let me explain to you what Guinness beer's role is in statistics. It has to do with this guy that's pictured here, somebody who was working at the Guinness Brewery. His name was William Seeley Gossett, who lived from 1876 to 1937. He was a brilliant mathematician and statistician who happened to have a job at a brewery. And one of the things that he had to do was take small samples from different ingredients that were going into making the beer. And he became sort of obsessed with this. He had to have these small samples and then try to draw inferences about what was going on in the population of whatever it was. So for instance, if he was looking at the best varieties of barley to use in the beer, he would have to take small samples of barley from different farmers and then try to then make an estimate or make an inference about what it would be like in the entire population of barley there for that farmer before they would go ahead and buy that crop and then use it in the beer. So in this sort of very practical problem of brewing Guinness beer, Seeley develops the test that we're going to talk about today, the t-test. So he develops this t-test, and he also develops the t-distribution that goes along with it. The unfortunate thing for him, though, is that he wasn't really free to share who he was to the academic community. And I think this is partly because Guinness wanted to keep his identity secret. They didn't want to have any nasty academics out there. So what he did was he ended up publishing papers on his new statistical technique for mathematics journals. And he published these papers under the pseudonym Student. So Student became his pseudonym, and in fact, after that, people referred to these new t-tests as Student's t-test. And you'll still see that occasionally if you look in a textbook or if you look at it in some online forum, you'll hear the t-test referred to often as Student's t-test. We now know that it was actually Gossett who did this, so you could call it Gossett's t-test, but the name still lingers. The Student t-test has to do with his pseudonym. All right, let's go ahead and talk a little bit more about why he did this. Why did he develop his t-test? Why was he forced to do this? And it comes back to that problem of the fact that he didn't know what the population standard deviation was. He realized he couldn't just use his z-test to do this, that he would be off a bit. He would not be estimating it properly, and therefore, because of that, his calculations might be off when he was actually trying to make inferences again about the population. So how does a t-test differ from a z-test? Well, there are three ways that it does. A t-test uses an estimate of the population standard deviation based on the sample standard deviation to produce an estimate of the standard error of the mean. So this means that we're going to be using that n minus 1 version of the standard deviation formula to produce this estimate of the population standard deviation and therefore produce an estimate of the standard error of the mean. Another way that it differs from a z-test is that unlike a z-test, each t-test has associated with it a certain number of degrees of freedom. That's related to the sample size and the number of parameters that are being estimated. So I'll be introducing this new formula for what's called the degrees of freedom. A t-test is based on a t-distribution, whereas a z-test is based on the normal distribution. So these last two points go together. We have this new distribution to introduce today that's going to have a slightly different shape based on the number of parameters that are being estimated. And in this calculation of the parameters that we're looking at, we'll get something called a degrees of freedom that I'll talk about in more detail in a moment. And the degrees of freedom are then used when we're looking at our t-distribution to figure out where our cutoffs are and that kind of thing. So let's take that first point about how the t-test differs from the z-test and use this estimate of our population standard deviation to produce an estimate of the standard error of the mean. So in hypothesis testing, we normally want to use this comparison distribution to do our hypothesis testing. And because we often are making inferences about means, where we go ahead and say in the null hypothesis, for instance, that the mean is not different from zero, we usually choose the distribution of means as our comparison distribution. Now, when you know the population standard deviation, sigma, then you can use that the formula that we covered last week to compute the standard error of the mean. So that's the formula that I showed you last week. So if I want to get the standard error of the mean, I know the population standard deviation, I can go ahead and take it and divide it by square root of n. I can also, by the way, if I have the variance, the population variance, I could have that as sigma squared, and I could put that into the formula and take that over n, and then take the whole thing under a radical, and I get the same thing. So either way, if I have the population variance or I have the population standard deviation, I can get my standard error of the mean. But again, this is all when we know the population standard deviation. But what about when we don't know the population? When we do not know the population standard deviation, what you do then is you use S, our estimate of the population standard deviation, to compute an estimate of the standard error. So here's our S. Now the S again is the formula for the standard deviation, where n minus 1 is in the denominator in the formula. So we go ahead and use that as our estimate of the population standard deviation, S. Then we take that and divide it by square root of n. And you can see that we now have this new symbol, S sub m, which stands for an estimate of the standard error. So now we have an estimate of what we think the standard error is like out there in the population of the distribution of means. But it is not the same thing as what we had before, because we're making an estimate. So here's our formula we introduced this week now when we don't know the population standard deviation. Go ahead and use your sample standard deviation as the n minus 1 version of the formula, and then divide it by the square root of n, and you'll have your estimate of the standard error. Now, keep in mind too that my second and third points are that the shape of this comparison distribution is different, so it doesn't necessarily follow a normal curve. And in fact, what Gossett found was that the distribution of means when you're estimating the population standard deviation isn't the shape necessarily of a normal curve. It's a little bit off. And what he determined was that when we are estimating it, the distribution of means follows a, what he called, a T distribution. Its exact shape depends on the degrees of freedom that are used to make the standard error estimate. In this case, its degrees of freedom is equal to n minus 1. Okay, so we are now using or introducing this thing called degrees of freedom. So let's just take a slight detour and talk about what degrees of freedom are. And it's sometimes italicized here as like df. So this n minus 1 correction has this special name, degrees of freedom. And this refers to the number of values that are free to vary when we're estimating a parameter. Now, it might be a little hard to understand what we mean by free to vary, so let me give you a really simple example. For example, let's say that we have a formula in which the formula says you have to choose four numbers that add to 100. So I have this thing set up where I have 100, and let's say I pick 25, then I pick 20, or then I pick 25. So now I've picked three numbers. Now you'll notice though that the fourth number has already been predetermined by the fact that I picked the other three. So my first three choices were all free to vary as much as I wanted, but my fourth number here has to be 30, right? So 25 plus 20 plus 25 plus 30 equals 100, and therefore I would now have that formula work out. If I tried again, and this time I decide that the first time I'll pick a 50, the second number I pick a 20, the third number I'll pick a 10, my fourth number, I don't really have a free choice here. What actually has to happen here is that I have to have 20 be my answer in order for it to work. And finally, when I have 10 plus 80 plus 5, then you can see that the only answer I can have there is 5. So in all of these problems, even though it looked like I was free to choose any four numbers that I wanted, I only really had 3 degrees of freedom. Only three of the numbers really were free to vary, and the fourth one was always determined by whatever the other three happened to be. That's basically what's happening when we talk about degrees of freedom here in estimating a parameter. And it's a little bit more complicated than that, but for now, just accept the fact that for every formula where there's some sort of estimate of a population parameter, there will be a degrees of freedom associated with it. And that means then you'll have to look to see, for instance, on the t-test, there's some different degrees of freedom for different kinds of t-tests, but the statistical formulas usually include a formula for computing the degrees of freedom. So you don't have to go and try to figure it out from scratch. You don't have to actually go through all the logic of a t-test to figure out how many values were free to vary. And instead, there'll be just a formula that comes along with it that tells you what the degrees of freedom are. Okay, so going back to what we were talking about with the t-distribution. So here's what a student, or I should say Gossett, figured out about the t-distribution. What he did was he figured out what the distribution of means would look like when we're estimating population standard deviations. And you can see that the mean of this distribution is always zero. So a t-value has a mean of zero in the middle of the distribution. And then you can see we have more extreme values that go from -4 to +4 out in the end. So in some ways, this looks a lot like the way the z-table looked like, where we had our z-scores and the middle of the distribution was a zero, and we could go up to 3 or 4 standard deviations and then get really rare out there. Same thing's true here for the t-distribution. Now you'll notice though that the only curve that's on here that's actually defined as a normal curve is the one that's sort of the light blue that's down at the bottom where it says standard normal. So the light blue is an actual normal distribution. All of the others are t-distributions for different degrees of freedom. So for example, we could pick degrees of freedom of 1, and you can see the more darkish blue is the one that sort of sticks in the middle there. It doesn't kind of reach up all the way to the top where the normal distribution would be. And also you'll notice that the tails kind of stick out a little bit higher on that particular curve. The red one represents degrees of freedom of 5. Then we have a light green that's degrees of freedom of 10. And when we get to the purple, you can see that the purple one, degrees of freedom of 30, is almost exactly right on top of a normal curve. It turns out that different degrees of freedom under 30 really do vary quite a bit away from the normal curve, but the closer you get to degrees of freedom of 30, the more it starts to take on exactly the shape of a normal curve. And in fact, you get to a high enough level, it is actually a normal curve, okay? So that is what a t-distribution looks like. And in order to figure out what the cutoffs are, you can go out there and find t-tables. We don't have one for the textbook that we're using right now, but the t-tables are freely available. You can look up on Google and find them. Here's one that I like. It's actually got the t-tables for one-tailed and two-tailed tests. The table itself is just showing you numbers for two-tailed tests. And so it says here the level of significance alpha level for a two-tailed test. So if you pick that middle column of 0.05, everything you see down below the 0.05 are different cutoffs for different degrees of freedom. The place where the tail would be a place where we could say anything beyond that is so rare when the null hypothesis is true that we'll reject the null hypothesis. Then you can also see the cutoff for 0.01 and 0.001 in the far right column. So we have plenty of choices here, again, just like we had with the Z test, in terms of where the cutoff is going to be. The main difference, of course, though, is that we have degrees of freedom now. So for every curve up to 30, we're going to have to know what the degrees of freedom are to look at it appropriately and find out where the cutoff is. Notice again that when you get to the very bottom of this table, it's got a little infinity for the degrees of freedom. So yes, if we reach infinity for degrees of freedom, you can see that the values for the cutoff, like look at 0.05, 1.96. Now that number should look familiar to you because 1.96 is the cutoff when we're using an alpha 0.05 in a two-tailed test that we had +1.96 and -1.96 on a normal curve in the Z table. Well, it turns out, like I said to you, that in a t-table, the t-distributions actually do finally reach at infinity the level of having a normal curve, and you get the same exact cutoffs. Everything between 30 and infinity is really, really close to 1.96. It's just a matter of just a little smidging, a little bit different, a little bit away from that. Okay, so I want to again emphasize, just from looking at that table, since it only goes up to 30, that Gossett really created the t-test for small samples. So when he was dealing with small samples, that's when he ran into this particular problem that estimating the population standard deviation could have in terms of figuring out whether or not it's a significant difference. And so that's why we like using t-tests when we have these smaller samples. Thank you.